I want to talk to you about a man who was born blind. He was born blind, and then he met Jesus, and because he met Jesus, he came to see. This is going to be a metaphor, a symbol, or a sign that we are spiritually blind. We come into this world, every one of us, spiritually blind. And then when we meet Jesus, if we truly trust and follow him, he enables us to see. But before I get into John 9, I want to kind of give you some context. Throughout the Gospel of John, we're going to keep doing what we've been doing, and that is actually show you some first century archaeology and support for this. Because what I think is really cool is that the places the Bible talks about, they're real places. The people like the high priest, and his name was Caiaphas, and these are real people. The places, the people, and the things, we're just finding that everything the Bible is teaching us is actually grounded in objective history, which is really encouraging. So the first picture, archaeologists, as we've been saying, reconstructed what first century Jerusalem looked like. And there's a picture of it from a different angle than we've showed in the other weeks. This is looking up from the south to the north. And in our story today, it's going to start in the temple area. And you can see the temple up there to the right, the upper right in the picture. And then the black lines are going down to a place called the Pool of Siloam. So I'm going to, as we tell the story, that's the journey. Jesus is going to spit on some mud and put it in this blind man's eyes up near the temple. And he's going to somehow, as a blind man, get down to this pool and wash himself. Now here's something that's really cool. In 8 years ago, they were putting some pipes in Jerusalem, and they had to clear away an area, and guess what they found? They found the Pool of Siloam. And it's taken about 6 years to dig away the dirt, and let's watch a clip just to help you imagine the reality of the story.
Well, we're here at the Pool of Siloam, and this is a recently excavated site. Until several years ago, they thought that behind this pool here, in that cleft of rock, back there through that little entranceway was the original Pool of Siloam, but that has been shown to be a Byzantine pool, a later period, past the New Testament. And they were excavating here, and they found, as they cleared this field away, a series of steps. You can see them going down here. There's my tumbler. You can see the steps going down. You can see steps coming up here and up here as well. And what they discovered is this is the southern end of the original Pool of Siloam. You'll see a corner right there. And so it would bend this way and continue, but it's blocked off by a field. This side of the pool continues, and we don't quite have the end yet on that that side. But from what I understand, this is owned by a farmer, I think a Muslim farmer, if I remember correctly, and the owner lives right up there. And he's very old and will probably be dead soon, and so in years to come, this whole pool may be unearthed. But until then, we have this little corner piece. This is, of course, shows up in Scripture in the New Testament, and it would have been a bustling place in that time. Usually it's dry. In fact, I was here 2 months ago, and it was dry all the way to the bottom. There was no water whatsoever. And this is because in Israel, there are two seasons. There's a rainy season and a wet season. And we have just entered now, as it's the beginning of November, into the rainy season. And so last night it rained. It was the first heavy rain here in Jerusalem. And so what's happening here is that this pool is overflowing and draining down into the Pool of Siloam, that once again becomes a pool, although it's usually dry land. So this is very neat to be here today. I was walking past it and saw it, so I wanted to show all of you.
So the next picture, Israeli archaeologists. Again, these guys, they're Jewish guys, they're not believers, but they reconstructed how it looked in the first century in the story, and that's how it would have looked. It helps us, again, to know people, places, culture. We discover what the Bible says is really true. And it helps us as we go back, as this story does, to the truth that Jesus is the light of the world. I want to ask you a question. what does a light do? What does a light do when it's really dark? Well, a light enables you to see what you can't see otherwise. For example, if you light a lamp like this one in the first century, they would have lit it, and it would have given light to the room, the table, the chairs, and the walls. Because Jesus is the light, we see God, we see people, we see life. We're blind to the real meaning of these things until Jesus becomes the light for us. Now, I'm about to take you through this story in John 9, and I want to ask you if you'll pull something out of your programs that you should have received when you came in. It says soap at the top. Actually, it doesn't say soap at the top. It says Psalm 31:3 at the top, and then it's got S-O-A-P. Can you all take that out and wave it at me? Oh, I like it. Woo! You like you're cheering for me. So, I'm going to guide you through soap today, and I want to teach you how to do this, because as a church, we're all in the Bible this year. We're all going to be, like this week, if your small group is starting like every other small group, you're going to find a psalm to read. And when we, in the journal that you're going to get, this journal, and by the way, if you don't have one of these, and if you're new with us, at the Connection Center, you can get one, your own journal today, and I'll follow along with it. And it's going to encourage you to do this thing called soap. Now, in my home group on Wednesday night, that sounded confusing to some newcomers that we had. Like, what's soap and how do you do that? And so we kind of walked through it. What I'd like to do today through John 9 is have somebody do soap. So you're going to, as we go through this chapter, there's going to be one verse that's going to stand out to you. You're going to have an observation about why it stands out, and then an application to your life and a prayer. And so I'm looking around. Would somebody volunteer to do soap for us this morning? I'm going to have you come up here, by the way, if you do it. Okay. Dean, you're a good man. Okay. Come up here, Dean. Okay. Actually, Aaron, I want you to do it too. Okay, buddy? I'll explain at the end. So as I go through John 9, I'm going to go through it, and I want you to pick out a verse. Now, what I did is... this is my soap this week from Psalm 31. So I was reading through it, and I picked out one verse. I actually wrote it down. So Psalm 31, as I read it, says, "You, God, are my rock and my fortress. For the honor of your name, lead me out of this danger." I thought that was cool. So then I did observation, application, and prayer. Now, you've done this before, so you're going to rock it. So at the end, I'm going to have you come up and share with us your soap, okay? So this explains how to do it. So when I was going through that psalm, I talked about how David not only relied on God, but affirmed that God's honor was at play as he answered David's prayers. And so I said September the 6th that I wanted to live for Christ and God today and put his interests first and leave my being in God's hands. And then I just prayed that way down below. You see that? Okay. Will you all join Dean and find a verse and write it in? Because we have a blank right there for you. And there's pens in the pew pockets in front of that for everybody. So if we could all do soap today, that would be cool. God will bless you for doing that. All right? So at Harpeth Community Church, we're seeking to be biblical disciples of Jesus. Behind everything we do, we want to be biblical disciples of Jesus. And one of the real important ways we do that is we get in the Bible. In fact, here's the language. We get in the Bible and then get in a group. So let me just frame it to you this way. Do you want to grow spiritually in the next year? How many people would say, yeah, I want to grow spiritually in the next year? All right, good. 90% of you want to grow. let me promise you something. The single most important thing to help you to grow is going to be that you daily get in the Word and on your knees. Now, the thing that's really going to help you to do that, if you do that with other people who are your friends. So get in the Word, get in a group with some friends so we can encourage each other to really trust and follow Jesus. Is that a good plan? Yeah, so we want to be disciples of Jesus and grow. So say it with me, would you? Let's get in the Word and get in a group. All right, we're going to help you to do that. All right, so John chapter 9, verse 1. As Jesus was passing by, he saw a man who was born blind from birth. And so his disciples want to know about that. This is a great opportunity, they say to one another, to ask a question about Like, why do bad things happen to good people? Like, how? What about a baby who's born blind? Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he would be born blind? Jesus answered, fortunately, guys, life is not like that. He said, it is not that this man sinned or his parents sinned. He was born that way that the works of God may be displayed in him. What a great line by Jesus. God will take whatever weakness, whatever ailment, whatever difficulty you have, and in the midst of it, he doesn't want us to figure out why we got it. He wants us to ask him to help it to be something in our lives where God's glorified, where God is manifest and made to look good. I'm an asthmatic. When I was a child, I was a terrible asthmatic, very chronic. And one of the things that's really great about it is God taught me how to be patient. You know, in many days you can't breathe when all my friends are playing sports and I can't keep up with them. But I really developed not a patience, but an endurance that he's really glorified by that. And I love this because Jesus is saying bad things are the context for God to do great things. And he says this, we must work the works of God while it is still light because nighttime's coming. And then he says in verse 5, he says, as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. Here's a blind man. Jesus says, I'm the light of the world. Now Jesus is talking beyond just physical. Having said these things, he spit on the ground. So Jesus is there and he literally spits on the dust and the dirt. He's spitting on it and he makes mud with the saliva and he goes up to the man and he anoints the man's eyes with his spit and dirt and gets them all over the man. Now, it looks like it's like kind of gross, right? Him spitting and putting it together and smushing that on a man's eyes. And then he says to him, he says, go wash in the pool of Siloam. And he sends him. The pool of Siloam means sent. So he goes and he washes his eyes. And the Bible doesn't make a big deal. It just says he comes back seeing. And then this man, everybody's going like, whoa. So his neighbors gather around. And everybody, they're talking about, is this really the guy we thought it was? You know, if you ever see somebody who's blind, and then all of a sudden they could see, just the fact that they're opening their eyes and they're navigating, it would be like, is this really the same guy? Because he used to be blind, and now he's functional, and he's walking around, you wonder, is it the same guy? What a great metaphor for a Christian. You know, I used to be blind, but now I see. I'm different because I see. So other people say, no, it's not him. Yeah, it is. So verse 13, they brought him before the Pharisees, the man who had been formerly blind. Now it was the Sabbath day when Jesus healed him. Oh, Jesus, you broke one of them, their rules. One of those rules that religious people came up with. So like, Jesus, you can't be who you say you are because you broke one of our rules. And so the Pharisees began to ask him how he received his sight. And he said, well, this guy, he put mud in my eyes, and I went and washed, and then I could see. Ah, this man, he can't be from God. He doesn't keep our rule about the Sabbath. It's so funny. We talked about this 2 weeks ago, and it's so true. As you read through the Gospel of John, the lame excuses that people have why they don't believe in Jesus. Like, they're just blind, and they want to be blind. They have filters that just skew their sight, and so they don't believe in Jesus. By the way, as it happened in the first century, it's so it happens today, right? How many people you know who reject Jesus have really listened to, been humble about Jesus? Well, he says, this man, he can't be that bad, because who else could have healed the blind man? They said, he opened his eyes. And so the man says to the Pharisees, he must be a prophet. Now, the Pharisees and the Jews, they don't believe that. And so but they got to investigate. Like, everybody's talking about it, you know. Somebody who's blind and now they can see. So everybody's investigating about it. They called the parents of the man. They said, is this your son? Yeah. Is he blind? Yeah. He is our son. He was blind and now he sees. We know that, but we don't know how he can see. He's of age. You'll have to ask him. And John tells us that the parents are skittish because they know that the Pharisees have decided anybody who believes in Jesus, they're going to get kicked out of the synagogue. And the parents are like, they're like taking the fifth, you know. Don't blame this on me. He's of age. Ask him. So they find him again. They bring him back in. And they say to him, give glory to God. We know that this man, you said who healed you, he's a sinner. He says, whether he's a sinner or not, I don't know. All I know, I just know one thing. I was blind, and now I see. Now I see. You know, there is such a difference when you don't know Jesus, how you look at life, how you look at your own life. What a difference when you don't really know Jesus and when you do. Cindy and I, that's my wife, we're discipling a young couple who've been coming to church, and we walk them through some of these studies about knowing about Jesus that the church has. It's called the Following Jesus material, and that they're going to get married in the fall, so we've been walking them through some stuff on marriage, and I just sat down with them, and I asked them, I said, what's the best thing that we could talk about for you about marriage? And we spent some time with it, and here's the answer. We want to know how we can stay married and really develop a marriage. And it came out, we want to have a marriage like people had 100 years ago, where they stayed together through thick and thin. And I said, great. Well, let's look at what the Bible says about it. And we were working through this book called Sacred Marriage, and it's the perspective of Jesus, and it shows, you know, how you can really, by making your marriage not about you, but about Jesus, and following Jesus, what a difference it is. And your whole perspective changes. When you know Jesus, you see your children differently. I'm raising my children to become followers of Jesus who are going to have a part in God's purposes in this world, and then we're going to live forever. Wow, that's light that a lot of parents don't have. How about money? Hey, when you know Jesus, you look at money very differently, right? We know that all the money that we have is just a gift from God for God's purposes, and so we trust him to take care of us. Jesus is my light. Because he is the light of my world, because he is the light of our world, we see things very differently than people who don't have Jesus. Verse 26, they said to him, what did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? And he answered, I've already told you, and you would not listen. He says, do you want to hear it again? Maybe you want to become his disciples. That's like an insult, man alive. And the version I have says, they reviled him. They reviled him. We don't use that word anymore, right? They reviled him. That's when you like rebuke him. That's when you say, you idiot. We don't want to be his disciples. See, when you're blind, you don't know that you're blind. You think you can see. And you think the person who can see, they can't see. It shouldn't surprise us when people don't understand. He says, well, that's an amazing thing. He says, I don't know where this man came from, and I don't know where he's going. All I know is that he opened my eyes. Since the beginning of the world, has it ever been said that somebody opened the eyes of a blind man? Well, they're just upset with him, and the Bible says they cast him out. Verse 35, Jesus heard that they'd cast him out, and having found him, he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? Jesus actually uses language here to describe, do you believe in the Son of Man? He answers, well, who is he, sir? And I'll believe in him. By the way, once he opens our eyes, of course, we go, oh, I get it. That's who you are. I believe. I'll follow. Yeah. And Jesus says, it is he who's speaking to you. He said, Lord, I believe. And he worshiped him. By the way, when you believe, that's what you do. When you believe in Jesus, when you genuinely, truly, deeply believe, the automatic response is worship. It's worship in the little things every day. It's taking your job and offering it back to Jesus. This is my job, but may I do this for your glory and honor. Jesus, this is my relationship with my children. May I relate to them to your glory and honor. Jesus, I might be a single person. I might be living my life alone, but may I do this in worship to you. And the Pharisees, they come to him and they say, are we blind? Verse 40, are we blind? Jesus said to them, if you were blind, you would have no guilt. But now that you say we see, your guilt remains. Here's what Jesus is saying. Dean, why don't you come on up? Tell me your soap. Here's the frightening thing, friends. I know what it's like not to believe in Jesus, because I've been there. And I know the categories that you put Christians in, and I know the way you think about it and dismiss it. When you think you know, and you're rejecting Jesus, he actually says your guilt is greater, because you actually have a blindness that you're responsible for. The man or the woman who truly and genuinely looks at Jesus with humility and says, is it possible he is the way, the truth, and the life? That's the man or the woman who, even though they are blind, they're admitting, I might be blind. They actually have the ability by doing that to really see. So, that's John 9. Dean, which verse stood out to you?
So, I wrote down, to this they replied, you were steeped in sin at birth. How dare you lecture us? And they threw him out.
What verse is that?
I don't remember.
34.
Verse 30, yeah. To this they replied, you were steeped in sin at birth. How dare you lecture us? And they threw him out.
So that's the scripture?
Yep.
Your observation?
My observation was, I said, they were so prideful and competitive, they missed the obvious miracle of this poor man. They should have been rejoicing because of his life was changed and he was healed.
Okay. The application?
Application is that I don't want to be blind because of my pride. I want to see God's obvious miracles in people's lives and in my own family.
Oh, that's good. Did you write down a prayer, Dean?
I did. I said, God, help me to be humble and gracious. Open my eyes so I can see your truth.
Oh, that's good. Thanks, Dean. Let's give him a hand, everybody. Good job. Hey, can we say it together? Let's get into the Word. And get into a group and unpack those things together. Well, I just want to encourage you. I was telling the elders we met early this morning that, we're really starting our fall right now. Labor Day is behind us. We're heading in. And I hope that you find that this is just really simple and easy, because it really is. This week, actually, as you go through it, And there was a little bit of confusion in some of the groups. You start off, and everybody can have this journal. Even if you're not in a group and you say, this church is not my home, you know what? I want you to just get one of those journals anyway, because this will bless you, and it's so easy to follow, and it'll help you to grow. So this week, we just want you to concentrate on finding a time and a place and just read one psalm, like I gave you my example there, okay? And then when you come together in your group, you're going to talk about that. Next week, next Sunday, we're going to start week two with Matthew chapter 1. So it's just reading one chapter a day, takes you 5 minutes. In fact, this week, Cindy and I, our group's a little bit ahead. So she's been asking me if I would have devotionals with her. She has her devotionals and I have mine. She said, would you do it with me, Bobby? And so we're at supper time, we're doing it. And I just got online and I played it from Bible Gateway, and we'll send that link to all of you. We played it, and then I wrote down my soap as we're listening to it and looking at it, and she wrote down hers, and then we shared them with each other, and we prayed. It took us 10 minutes, and really felt good about that, really felt good about our spiritual unity together. So husbands, I just want to encourage you to do that. And then in 2 weeks, we're going to start watching these videos, like 20 minutes in our home groups, called Jesus 101, and it's great. It's going to rock your world and help you to really grow. And why are we doing all this? Well, because we're trying to be biblical disciples of Jesus who worship God and live for God. And we're all going to worship God daily by doing this. We're all going to grow together, because we're going to see actually what this text said. We're going to see that Jesus really is the light of the world. He is our light. He shows us how to live. He shows us how to encourage each other. He shows us how to think about eternity, to think about the day, how to think about our work. He really is the light of the world.